We're starting a new series this morning. Anyone thrilled and excited about that? And the title of the series is Planted. Planted. Very simply, this is what we're going to be talking about over the course of the next several weeks. And we're going to be talking about ways in which you can move your life, ways in which you and I can move our life into the best possible place for growth. Amen. And for us to grow well. Amen. To plant yourself and to be planted in the place where we will grow best. Hallelujah. There's a place that God has for each and every one of us, and He knows what place that is, and He knows where we're going to grow best. And so right here in the first chapter of the 21st chapter, 28th verse, it says, be fruitful. This is what God gave to man. These are the first words that mankind heard. Look at this. God blessed man saying these words. These are the first words that touched man's ears. Be blessed. Be fruitful. More accurately from the New King James. And multiply. Now this word fruitful means to be full of fruit. Amen. Now God wants your life to be a full life. And in fact, as believers, you know, as the church, if we're empty, lacking fruit, lacking the infilling of the Holy Spirit, what can we give to a very empty world unless we got something to give them? And so I believe that God, in fact, He commands it, longs for us to experience and have fruit. Not just any kind of fruit, but fruit that lasts. Not fruit that dries up and withers, but fruit that lasts. God demands it. Amen? Amen. And so we need to know then, if God demands it, He commands it. We need to know, you and I need to know, how we can get into the best possible place for that growth that God commands. Amen. We need to know how to get into that best possible place for God, where we'll experience the growth that God expects. Amen. Our theme scripture for this series is found in Psalms 92. And more specifically, we're going to be reading from verse 12 through to verse 14. And this is quite a powerful promise. I mean, it is a powerful promise. Yeah. It's a sure promise. And just listen to the words here. It says, then God blessed them. No, that's still Genesis 1. This is Psalms 92, verse 12. The righteous, is that anyone else?
Yes.
Are you righteous?
Yes.
Woo, come on, we're righteous. What does that mean? I've been made right.
Yes.
I have a right now, having been made right, to stand before the Father without any guilt, shame, sense of inferiority, because the blood has been shed, and I'm now the righteousness of God in Christ Jesus, that according to 2 Corinthians chapter 5, 21, that He became sin so that I might become the righteousness of God found in Jesus Christ. Amen? So, Jesus couldn't die until He became sin, just as much as you couldn't live before you became righteous.
Hallelujah.
And so this is talking to a whole bunch of us who have accepted Jesus as our Lord. We're righteous.
Amen.
The righteous, that's you and I. Might I pay attention to things like this? Shall flourish like a palm tree and shall grow like a cedar in Lebanon. Now notice this. This is a sure word. Verse 13. Come on. Those who are planted in the house. Come on now. Those who are planted in the house shall flourish in the courts of our God or in the presence of God. Now those who prosper in the spirit and prosper in the courts of God are those who are planted. It's the planted ones. Planted where? In the house. Those who are planted in the house, they shall flourish in the courts. You can't flourish in the courts before you've been planted in the house. In the house. Well, don't you know, Paul said, that you are the house of God, the temple of the Holy Ghost? Oh, yeah. Oh, man, we know that, right? We are the temple. Anyone else the temple of the Holy Ghost? Well, in the Old Covenant, the Old Testament, we have a picture of the temple, the tabernacle, where you've got the inner court and the most holy of holies, and we haven't got time to look at that and show you all the different, you know, significance of every part of the temple, but we now are what carries the Holy Spirit. Yeah. Amen?
Amen?
And that's what we are. We are the universal church, but also there is a local body, a local church. Yeah. There is the universal church, and then there is the local house. And he says, those who are planted in the house that God has led them to, called them to, those who are planted there shall flourish.
Yes. Yes.
Oh, glory to God, man. Now, is this a year of like flourishing? The faithful shall
flourish.
Is that what Jerry Seville said?
Yeah. Yeah.
So in order for us to kind of hook up with that flourishing and experience the flourishing, man, I need to know what it means to be planted. This series would be pretty important then, right?
Yes. Yeah.
Now, you've got on good authority that, hey, man, this is a year for me to flourish. Why? Because I'm planted, and I know what that looks like. So we're going to endeavor to unwrap this and look at it in more detail here. Praise the Lord. All right. Notice in verse 13, the promise is for those that are planted in the house of the Lord. The promise is for those who are planted. Verse 13, you can see that. And the New Living Translation, the guys are going to be quicker at the back. I'm exercising a bit of patience with them, but they're doing such a wonderful job, aren't they? Praise the Lord, man. I appreciate them. So they can pull up this same verse, verse 13 from the New Living Translation. Instead of using the word planted, it uses the word transplanted. Transplanted. Come on, transplanted. Colossians, the first chapter, the 13th verse. Whew, man. Just another devil fell, right? Yeah. Colossians 1:13 says that we have been transferred or transplanted from the kingdom of darkness. Come on now, from the kingdom of darkness into the kingdom of light. Come on, you got transplanted. You taken out of, uprooted, come on, uprooted out of the deathly soil, and you have been planted into, come on, life-giving kingdom of God, the soil that gives all the nourishment that you will ever need. That's where you got planted. Transplanted. We'll come back to that word transplant in a moment, perhaps. Definitely during the course of this series, we will do. Hallelujah. Now, the Bible is saying if you're going to be planted, it's through that planting you will flourish.
Yeah.
It's through the planting you're going to flourish. So straight away, I now have a great appreciation, and I now see the importance of being planted in a house. If it's through the planting that I'll experience flourishing, now planting is pretty important to me. Now, you've got to ask and you've got to self-assess always. But if you do a self-assessment and find out that, hey, I'm not flourishing. Well, you've got to check, am I planted?
Yeah.
Am I planted? And then secondly, if you answer, well, yeah, I am planted. Are you planted in the right place? Where are you planted? Where are you planted? Planted. Now, let me use an example. You know, often when people buy a brand new house on a brand new estate, you know, especially those showrooms. Usually, it's the first house, you know, on the estate where they put all the extras in, right? And so that they take the prospective buyer to the showroom. And you'll see right in the front lawn and the front garden and the back garden, you've got some beautiful plants. I mean, you think, wow, this house just got built, but it looks like it's got a mature garden. It's got a garden with like flowers that take years to grow and produce fruit. And here it is. It's looking pretty It's looking like a real beauty. It's flourishing. This garden's flourishing, right? Now, too often than not, what they do is they just plant beautiful, healthy-looking plants just everywhere and don't consider the position of those plants. Now, for us, when we bought our house, we learned real quick where the sun sets and where the sun goes down in relation to the location of our house. No, we didn't just learn where the sun sets. When we bought our house, we knew that before, but we kind of put the two and two together and got our bearings and appreciated where we ought to plant plants. And but we, admittedly, we planted plants in the wrong side of the garden and on the other side of the garden. But you know what? On specifically on the left-hand side, I tell you, no matter what we did, no matter what we fed our plants, they died. And we figured out these plants aren't getting enough sunlight. So we've got to uproot these things, and we've got to put them where they are going to get enough and adequate sunlight. Right? And so so that was very important. The planting is important in order for these bulbs to actually germinate and produce what they're supposed to. Come on now.
Yes, yes, yes.
Now, anyone know, you know what germination is, right? Okay. Okay, we'll talk about that in a minute. Praise the Lord. Man, this is a good class this morning. Should we talk about photosynthesis as well while we're at it? Should we talk about where the sun sets and where the sun rises? All right. You've got to consider, yes, this seed must be planted before it grows and produces. Right?
Yes.
Must be planted before it flourishes. But not only that, I need to figure out real quick where this ought to be planted. I need to consider the location. Now, we started planting flowers in the right side of the garden where they should really flourish. But they still didn't flourish, no matter what we used. I mean, Miracle-Gro. Talking about Miracle-Gro, anyone ever use Miracle-Gro? If you get a plant planted, I tell you what, in the soil that God's endeavored, if you get planted in His soil, forget Miracle-Gro. Miracles are happening where you're being planted by Him. But no matter what we did, they still died on us. And we then figured, do you know what? It's not just the location, but what is it planted in? So we dug up the soil and changed the flower beds and got some real good soil in there, and we're still endeavoring to get a good flower harvest in our back garden. And when we do, we'll take pictures and we'll spread them on Facebook and we'll show you how amazing we are at planting plants. And we'll ask you for a share too. Share it, retweet it. See, too often than not, especially when you consider the selling of a property, the seller will plant plants to show, to impress. Just to show. But not for growth.
Yeah. Yeah.
Now, we want growth.
Yeah.
We want fruit that's going to last us, right?
Yeah.
You want fruit that's going to last you?
Yeah.
Well, you got to consider where you're being planted.
Yeah.
And so I want to use an example real fast, and the guys are going to pull this and put this on the stage right now. I want to show you this. Look. A lot of people say, well, I am planted. I am planted. I'm planted in the house. But really, you've got to consider whether or not, thank you, Andre. Praise the Lord. Who is it? Yeah, it is Andre. Thank you. You guys could be brothers. Here we have two pots. We have one which already has a plant in it. And it looks like it's doing all right. Do you think it's doing all right? It's doing all right. And if I pull it, well, yeah, let me just pull this guy up. Look at that. Oh, look at that. Isn't that something? It's the root system in this plant is literally laying hold off. Literally grabbing a hold off the soil from which it's drawing its nutrients. All right? It's like a tat, it's one with. Now, we got at the moment, we have an empty pot here, But we got some good looking flowers. Anyone like this? Evidently a girl bought these flowers, being pink. But notice this, we could put that in there like that. And my, oh, don't fall over, please. Allison, I know you'll laugh. Don't laugh, please. here we go. Look at this. Which one looks more flourishing? This one, right? It looks like it's flourishing right now. But we haven't got an appreciation of what's below surface level. See, the enemy will try and, as much as God will endeavor to get you planted in the right place, the enemy will try and take you out the right place. Yeah. Remember what Jesus said to Simon? Simon, Simon, Satan is after you. He's asking for you. In other words, you know, he can't just come after you unless you give him permission. Yeah. But he's wanting to sift you like wheat, remove you from the good, come on, and leave you with nothing but the bad. And that's exactly what Satan wants to do. He wants to take you out of position. If he can take you out of position, then you can't take possession of the stuff that God has for you. And so you can't, now look at this. You can't take this guy, separate this guy to what's giving it nutrients. It's one with.
Yes.
But yeah, it doesn't look as flourishing as this guy. But what about this guy? Oh.
Yeah.
Plucked straight out.
Yeah.
No issues. Well, I am planted. I show up to church every week. Is it for show? Is it just to be seen or tick a box that will appease your conscience that, oh, I'm at church? Or are you actually planted in the house? Because those who are planted, so those who are planted will flourish. I need to know what planted looks like. Now, we're going to be on this series for however many weeks we need to be on this series. But the Lord's going to help us distinguish whether or not I am a planted one. Because if I am, then I can then, with a bold declaration of faith, say I am flourishing in this great year of great momentum. Come on now. But what's happening down below is very important. That's why we've got to go deeper. And that's what 2017 is about, right? Everyone with me? So what are you planted in? And we're going to look at Elise, and I've looked at, and this study, as it always does, increases as we dive into it. But we're going to look at least four things that ought to be planted in the house of God. At least four things. Now today we're looking at the first one, and that is you. You ought to be planted in the house. Now we'll look at some others of what ought to be planted in the house, but also we're going to look at what you ought to be planted in. What you ought to be planted in. Woo, glory to God. Straight away, you could give me some answers. What ought you be planted in? Love. What did Paul say in Ephesians chapter 3, verse 10? He said that you may be rooted and grounded. Come on, planted in love. What else ought you be rooted and grounded in? What else ought you be planted in? Come on, talk to me, church. Faith. Come on, which really comes from the Word of God, right? Faith, Hebrews 10, 17, faith comes by hearing, hearing by the Word of God. So if I get planted in the Word, and if I allow, just put up James chapter 1, verse 21 for a moment. If I receive with meekness the implanted, engrafted, James 1, 21, Word of God, then whatever's not right and is dead and needs saving, resurrecting will be. But the planting of that word and the implanted or engrafting of the word of God is very important. Has planted in your hearts. What? The word. The word.
Yeah.
So we're going to look into this subject in great detail and be planted in the stuff we need to be planted in. Glory to God.
Yes.
And we will identify at least four areas that we must be praise the Lord, that we ought to plant in the house of God. The first one is you and I. Amen?
Amen.
And so your success has a lot to do with, number one, where you're planted, what you are planted in, and number three, why you were planted there.
Yes.
How many of those are why?
Yes.
I said this in the first service, that so often that we get so consumed with the what that we forget the why. It's not so much the what we do, but why we do what we do that is important and powerful. You understand what I'm saying?
Yeah.
It's not just the singing. We're not just coming to church and doing some singing.
No.
It's not the what, it's the why we're doing what we're doing. You know, we ought to not just sing, we ought to fill our singing. Come on, people.
Yes.
Come on, work with me.
Yes, yes,
yes. We ought to fill our singing with thanksgiving. And fill our singing with honor and appreciation. Now I'm answering the why I'm singing.
Yes.
I'm singing because I'm really, what I'm doing is I'm worshiping, I'm thanking Him, I'm honoring Him through my singing. So now my singing has turned into worship.
Yes.
It's not the what, but the why we're doing what we're doing.
Yeah.
The same we're giving and tithing too. I'm not just writing a check, you know, like I write a check to the mortgage company, you know, to pay for my house or whatever it may be. No, you know, I'm coming with that check, with the tithe, with the offering, and I'm filling it. Come on, I'm literally filling that gift with thanksgiving and honor, knowing that according to Hebrews, the 7th chapter, that Jesus, the high priest, is receiving this. He's receiving it. And it's and I'm not just doing the what, I understand the why in what I'm doing. And so we've got to appreciate where you're planted, what you're planted in, and why you're planted where you are planted. Amen.
Amen.
Let's have a look at another precious promise here in verse 14. This is Psalms 92. This is our theme scripture. You glad you're in church, people?
Yes.
Some of you, I know you're doubling up and you've come to the second service as well. So some of this you heard in the first service. So you know where I'm going to go, but I want you to put some enthusiasm in there whilst hearing these things, even though you're hearing it for the second time. Amen. It says in verse 14, and they shall still bear fruit in old age. Who? The planted ones. And they shall, Tony's saying yes, he's agreeing with this. He's a little bit older than me, just a little. But man, you're young. He's renewing your youth like the eagles, guys. They shall still bear fruit in old age. They shall be fresh and flourishing. Fresh and flourishing. That means in all seasons, for as long as possible. Come on, not slowing down, relentless. You heard the message last week. Relentless, knowing that the stuff I've been planted in is giving me enough nourishment and life so that I can keep on running further, faster. I consider myself not having apprehended all the things that have been laid up for me in Christ Jesus. So what do? Paul said, I press forward. This is the one thing I do. I forget those things that are behind me. I'm pressing forward to the prize of the high calling. There's more. There's more living to be lived. There's a more life. There's a more life. And I love when Pastor Joel Sims, he came and he taught on this so well. He said, you know, in the heart of it, the heart of every man, every woman, there's a version of you in you that you have not yet seen. There's a version of you in you that the world has not even witnessed yet. That in the heart of every person, in the soul of every man, every woman, every child, there is this sense there's more. There's more to experience. And there is more. There's more to experience. And staying then planted. Staying where He's placed you. The place where He knows there's the exact nutrients that you need right there in order for you to run your race is vitally important, because there's something coming. You know, you hear that phrase, there's something in the river. Young voices, you know, my girls, they sang these songs over and over and over and over again. And there's something in the water. There's something in the river. Well, there's something in, come on, there's something in the soil.
Hallelujah.
There's just something in the soil where God has planted and positioned you. Woo! Miracle grow. Now, verse 4, it says, in old age, This means the place in which we are to be planted is to sustain us through the course of our life. Come on, if planted, you're not going to wither. You're not going to dry up. You're not going to fade out. You're not going to die. Come on. You know, the fruit is not going to dry up and die. Why? Because God didn't plant you there just to impress you. He didn't just plant you there just to, like, it didn't take a few minutes, but it's already looking pretty sorry, right? And no. There's just some things that you can't get any other way but through longevity. And an appreciation that you must, before you go up, you must go down. Yes. There must be things that are happening in the unseen before you see it in the seen. What are we talking about? We're talking about root system. There's a whole lot more going on here, under here, than what's going on in there.
Yes.
See, don't ever allow what your eyes see determine what your heart believes. Amen. For we walk by faith and not by sight. Thank you, Holy Ghost. Thank you, Father. Whew. Hashtag fat fruit. That's what God wants for you. Come on now. Fat fruit. Heavy loaded. That's a good word, loaded. With fruit. Fruit that will last. That will give Him glory. Will not fade. Being planted is the difference. Hallelujah. Being planted is the difference. Now, let's look at this in a little bit more detail. I just want to pick out a word. We've read it already, but look at this word in verse 13 in our theme scripture. Psalms 92, verse 13. It says, those, as you can see on the screen, those planted, those that be planted. Why don't you just turn to somebody and say, be planted. Be planted. Titus is a good verse, I'm sure. But let's look at Psalms 92, verse 13. It says, those that be planted. So that those are talking about who? People. People that are planted. People that are planted. And so we're looking at this. Now, let's build upon this idea of planting yourself in the house of God a little bit further by looking at a few scriptures. You ready for this? Look at this. Psalms 27, verse 4. Psalms 27, verse 4. Man, this is good stuff here. I feel, and I told this to the early crowd, that I felt like I didn't even get my intro out. But anyway, are we here? This is Psalms 27, verse 4. It says, one thing I have desired of the Lord, and that will I seek, that I may dwell in the, here we go again, the house, that I may dwell, live, abide, remain, come on, continually, denotes a continual living, in the house of the Lord all the days of my life. Come on, not just on weekends. Do you know what God wants? God wants full custody of His kids.
Yes.
He don't want to just see Him on the weekends. He wants full custody.
Amen.
Instead of just, oh, well, you can only see me on Saturdays between 11 a.m. and 12:15. No, He wants full custody of His kids.
Yeah.
All the days of my life. Now, isn't this something? He said this one thing, such focus. I came across a quote by Thomas Edison. He said, many men think of many things all day long, but I think of one thing all day long.
Yeah.
Isn't that something?
Yeah.
There's so many things racing through our minds all the time, but if you were just to get focused, there's power in focus, being focused on assignment and getting that assignment done from front to back. Amen?
Yeah.
Well, David made this big, big statement, this one thing. And so you'll never build a solid faith based on a weak focus. When we are focused in on the Word of God, come on, somebody.
Yeah.
Your faith is, it comes alive through hearing the Word, but your faith is, how can I put it, it's empowered by focus.
Yeah. Yeah.
And he's saying here, you know, this is my one focus, my one desire, and that is that I may dwell, remain in the house of the Lord. Now, let's have a look at another one here. Psalms 23, verse 6. Psalms 23, verse 6. I'm going to wait for it to get on the screen here. Psalm 23, verse 6. This is why my messages are so long. I've got to find someone to blame. I'm joking. You guys are doing amazing at the back. And so Psalm 23, verse 6 right here says, surely goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life, and I will dwell in the house of the Lord forever. Now, you check out this word dwell. It means to live at a specified place. A specified place. All right? So David specified his place. And the place was the house of the Lord. David knew there is just something about God's house that causes me to flourish. And if I can remain and stay planted in the house of the Lord, then I will prosper, I will flourish, and I will grow well. Young King Uzziah, he said in 2 Chronicles 26, verse 5, it says concerning him that as long as the young 16-year-old king sought the Lord made him to prosper, made him win, made him flourish. So his focus was right. Amen. His focus was right. So I'll put this down in my notes. Until we are planted, we cannot produce roots. Until we have roots, we cannot produce fruits. No root, no fruit. Bad root, bad fruit. Good root, good fruit. So until we're planted, we can't produce roots. Until we have roots, we cannot produce fruits. And until we have fruit, we cannot fulfill our call. Because that is the, theologians would call it, the Genesis mandate. And that is to be fruitful. That's your calling. To be fruitful. In fact, if you, it's quite sobering. When you check out the comments that Jesus made in John 15, where it talks about, you know, abide in me and let my words abide in you. And you may ask the Father anything, you know, and he's going to give it to you, you know, the desires of your heart. And it's through your much fruit bearing, he goes on to say, that my Father is what? Glorified. He gets glory when you bear much fruit. And you get satisfied, your joy becomes full in your fruit bearing. You're fulfilling the very first assignment given to man, and that is to bear fruit, to grow well, and to flourish. But you can't unless you get roots. And you can't get roots unless you're planted. But you can't get fruit unless you're rooted. And you can't get fruit even if you're rooted, but only rooted for a short period of time. You got to stick with it. Like I said, there's certain things that will come into your life because of longevity, and it can't come in any other way. You got to stick with it. I said you got to stick with it. And here's the deal. If you are producing fruit, you will be pruned to produce more fruit. If you're not producing fruit, then you will be plucked up and out. Is that the truth? How many think this is important? It will take a seed being put in a place of permanency so that the roots can grow down deep and then draw from that place. Now, notice it's not just what, but where. Let's look at this. Time has escaped me. I don't think I've ever finished a message. I've never finished the message I've endeavored to preach in my life. Apart from that Nagamese service that lasted for 5 hours. But we were in America. Just turn to Psalms 1. We were in America and Brother Copeland preached for 7.5 hours. Amen. Any one of these weekends, you up for a 7.5 hour message? No one. Oh, but two. All right, so we're going to have a low crowd. I'll give you plenty of warning, and the four of us will meet. First chapter here, Psalms 1. Psalms 1. Praise the Lord. Blessed is the man. Who walks not in the counsel of the ungodly, nor stands in the seat of nor stands in the path of sinners, nor sits in the seat of the scornful. But his delight is in. Come on now, next verse. Let's see it. But his delight is in the law of the Lord, and in his law he meditates day and night. Next verse. He shall be, come on now, the guy who meditates, the blessed man who delights. He shall be like a tree that is planted by. It's not just who or what you plant, but it's where you're planted. I think some people are planted by the river and they're flourishing. Woo, come on now. The nourishment's there. The stuff you need is there. And God is a strategist. He knows exactly how to plant you exactly where you need to be. For some others, it seems like, man, even though they perhaps know the truth behind some of the things we're saying, they plant themselves next to the septic tank. They plant themselves in front of that TV watching EastEnders with the people who are scornful, with people who are running off doing all kinds of crazy stuff. Right? See, everyone is our ministry. Not everyone ought to be our friend. Hallelujah. So planted by, see, it's the location also. And in fact, your location, where you're planted, will determine your prosperity. And so you got to self-assess, am I planted in the right place? Now, well, I attend this church. I should be flourishing. Well, are you just planted for show? And so, you know, the one storm comes and you know, just knocks you straight over. Here's the deal. Let's get rid of this guy temporarily. Beautiful flowers, but not so impressive looking right now. Even this picture here. This is a picture of people who isolate themselves. Well, I am the temple of God. You know, God doesn't live in a building. He lives in me. Is that true? That's the gospel truth. As Andrew Womack would say, gospel truth. Yeah, amen. He lives in you. He lives in you. But here's the deal. If you just think, well, me and Jesus are enough. Just me and Jesus. That's all I need is me and Jesus. Me and Jesus, the Holy Ghost, and my Bible. Man, we have some amazing times. I don't doubt it for a second. I do too. Amazing times. But that whole organized religion is full of hypocrites. Well, there's hypocrites everywhere. Hypocrites in the restaurant. So just because there's hypocrites in the restaurant means you never go to the restaurant? I mean, I went to that steakhouse and I ordered steak and I just fancied a steak. So I went in there, ordered a steak, and I asked my waitress, what steak would you recommend from the menu? Oh, I don't like steak. I don't eat steak. So you work in a steak restaurant and you don't eat, are you one of those vegetarians? It's against my religion not to eat meat. No, I'm joking. Just forget that. Making all kinds of doctrine up right now. So you are a hypocrite serving steak and you don't even eat it yourself. See, there's hypocrites everywhere. But what if that's the best steak in the house, in the city? The steak house in the city. Just because those who are dishing it out don't eat it themselves, you don't go back to the restaurant. There's hypocrites everywhere. There ought not to be in the house. You understand what I'm saying?
Yeah.
There ought not to be. You understand what I'm saying?
Yeah.
There ought not to be. Yeah. Now, it would be wise you getting along people who are not hypocrites.
That's true.
Right? and attaching your life with people who are actually doing the word, because how many know good morals are corrupted by company? You could say it the other way around, right? More accurately, here's the deal. If I'm just me and Jesus, because I have no limit, I mean, me and Jesus, I can access him. Like Evie would say, Evie preached a great message on this, and I listen to it every so often in my living room on my own, about the blood of Jesus gains me access into the throne room of grace. So that's all I need is his presence. Well, if that's you, then you've just isolated yourself. That's now you are limited to whatever you put in this pot. That's it. You're limited to what can go in this pot. That's it. And if a storm comes, and the storms of life will come, it'll hit you. You will come tumbling off here. And if you were in a ceramic pot, then you're liable to get cracked and broken. Now your container is hit. And the very stuff that you've been pouring in self, just all about me, it's all about me, it's all about my growth, it's all about me. Now, you haven't got a good handle on this, and you have no other support system around you to undergird you. Here's the thing. When you and I are planted in the house with those who are planted in that same house, my root system, come on now, Isaiah 54 verse 2 says, lengthen your cords, lengthen your roots. When my roots go down deep in the unseen realm of God, and because I'm hearing the same stuff that Seth's hearing, his root systems are going down deep too. And what's happening? My roots are connecting with his roots, connecting to Ugo's roots, connected to Annie's roots, connected to Susan's roots, connected to Joseph's roots, connected to Tony's roots. Come on now. And now we are strong together, because our root systems are interconnecting, intertwining. And now, what the stuff that's going on underneath in the unseen realm is helping us and securing us and making us stronger than what we ever could be in a pot. Yeah. So when the storms of life come and hit, the same storm hits us, hits the pot falls over, we stand. Why? Because our lives are intermingled, connected. Hallelujah. I'm out of time, aren't I? I was out of time a long time ago. I'm not used to that. I was preaching a long time in India. But I'm out of time. What do I do? What do you do when you're out of time? Close your Bible. All right, guys. Yeah, I'll see you next week. We'll see you next week. Everyone stand up. Everyone stand up. We've got to close. Everyone stand up. Come on. Man, I feel like I'm like not even getting into this stuff. But anyway. We're a church. We'll come back. Thank you, Holy Ghost. He's our helper, isn't he?
Yes.
He's our helper, isn't he? Yes, he is. Yes, he is. Do you know what? Do you know what every sheep needs? Two things, a shepherd and a flock. You need a place where you can hear from God. And I know most of you in this place are, you know, this is family. We're home right now. This is your place. You've been coming to this place for a while. We all need a place, and we all need to appreciate the place that God's planted us. Why? Because when you need a word, something about the house. Jesus was a man of custom. As it was his custom, he came to the synagogue. When David messed up, where did he go? He went to the house. There's something at the house. Come on, every one of us needs a house we can go to. Paul and Silas, they were, you know, no, not Paul and Silas. Peter and John in Acts 4, they were threatened not to preach in the name of Jesus. Their lives were threatened. They were threatened to death. And so what did they do? They went to the house. They went to their company. And what did the house do? They prayed and strengthened them. There's just something about the house of God. Come in, like this, like we are right now, like we are right now, that we get to hear a message that if you're lacking faith, faith comes into your heart. Where you're lost and you need some wisdom on something, there's just something about coming and hearing from that under shepherd. That direction comes through the preaching of the word, or through the worship, or through whatever happens after we close the service, during connection time, during teas and coffees. Direction comes. If you're hurt, healing comes. There's something in the soil that is more potent and rich. How many know the soil of the kingdom is so different to the soil that's in the world?
Yes.
It's so different. That Isaac, in the time of famine, he sowed in God's soil. And in the same year, reaped 100-fold. Why? Because it's rich. It's full of deposits. Placed there by the Father. Made and put there by the Father for you to draw. God made Eden, the Garden of Eden, full, rich, and then he planted man in the garden. Just like he's planting many into churches around the globe where they can find exactly what they need, when they need it, and hook up to the right root systems and the right individuals that God's called them to hook up to. So when the storm does come, they won't fall flat on the face, but they'll remain standing, having done all to stand. In the name of Jesus. Every sheep needs a shepherd, and every shepherd needs a flock. Sheep are who you are, and that is far from a compliment, because sheep are pretty dumb animals. They have no, you know, they're top heavy, they roll over very easy. You know, you'll never see a sheep sprint. They aren't like a gazelle that have strong muscular legs that if a predator comes, they can get away quickly. Sheep, I mean, a sheep says, eat me. I am lunch if you're looking for it. But we get a sheep in a flock to a predator, now it looks like, woo, a lot bigger than what it actually is. Come on now. And if I mess with that sheep, then I'm going to mess with the whole flock. Because when one falls, come on, when one laughs, we all laugh. When one cries, come on, we attend to that. As a family, I tell you, this year, if anything, we're going to grow stronger together. This is one of our focus points for this year, and that is growth. And one of the best things, if you're not already in it, is join a life group. Get connected to a life group. Find life, new life. As a pastor, you know, I can't chat to everyone every day. I can't, you know, meet everyone. But if I know you're in a life group, if the team knows you're in a life group, I know you're taken care of. And I want that life group to be a safe harbor whereby you can get the support, the prayer support, and the encouragement that every one of us needs. And if there's a pastoral matter that needs to be brought to our attention, it will be brought to our attention through the life group leader. It's one way I know that you're being taken care of. And that's so important to me as a pastor, because everyone knows that, you know, us laboring in prayer and praying for you guys and watching over the souls of this great assembly. I don't want anyone bleeding alone or feeling alone. I want every one of us to feel connected. Are you planted? And we'll unwrap that as we move on and come back to church, amen, as we progress in this series. Father, I pray for every one of us, everyone in this place, the Lord, that we would really just, appreciate what you've done in bringing these lives together. Lord, thank you that you've placed me here. And I pray that, Lord, you would show each and every one of us in this room that this is supernatural. This is not just happenstance. This isn't coincidence. That, Lord, you've strategically brought these lives from all these different nations together to do life together, to strengthen. And Lord, I pray that we would not only be here, but that we would assemble together as we ought. So when the storm does come, we will not be moved, because we have people praying for us, people speaking the word over us, people pleading the promises of God and the blood of Jesus over our lives. No enemy, no circumstance, no storm, no devil in hell can knock us off our position in you, strong in the Lord and strong in the power of your might, because we've found a community, woo, glory to God, whereby we watch over each other's lives. Lord, speak to us. If there be anyone in this room who's disconnected, feeling isolated, I pray that, Lord, they wouldn't have to feel isolated or disconnected anymore, but you would help them make a decision to be a part of this local church and get planted in here as part of this family. And when they made that decision, Lord, that you will honor that decision, and they'll find and they'll feed on the very stuff that we've been feeding on, and the nourishment will come into their life, and it'll bring healing and wholeness and deliverance, and exactly what they need, they'll find it, because they've been divinely connected to the place that you've willed for them to be. In Jesus' name, thank you, Holy Ghost. Thank you, Jesus.